short ride to work hard, and now he deserves the rest that he needs.
We celebrate the life of President Fidel Ramos, who has brought so much honor, dignity to the presidency, and brought us, the Filipinos, to greater heights in the international community.
FVR will forever be remembered for his genuine love of country, overwhelming dedication to public service, and excellent stewardship of the Philippine economy in the midst of formidable challenges.
Our country has lost one of its most steadfast pillars, but we take comfort that President Ramos's monumental legacy will continue to live on, not only in the physical things that were built, but also within every Filipino whose life was made much richer by everything that he made possible.
Thank you for giving me a name that I could say that I am proud of. Ramos. That is a name with so much history, so much passion and hard work already baked into it. And it wouldn't have been that way if it wasn't for you.
Looking back over FVR's past life, we might ask ourselves, if we each live as long and achieve even only half as much as FVR, what good might we do for ourselves, for our families, for our communities, for this country? Imagine all the more what good we might do if we did it together. Now, a grateful nation thanks Fidel Valdez Ramos for his service. A loving family will grieve his absence, and we will all cherish what he has taught us. Now it is time for this old soldier's well-deserved rest. He fought the good fight. He has finished his work.
Stability, the seeming battle cry of the late former Philippine President Fidel Valdez Ramos when he assumed office in 1992. That word resonated within the whole government under his watch. I'm Tina Monzon Palma. This is ANC Presents Farewell Steady Eddie. In the next 30 minutes, join us as we look back at the life, leadership, and legacy the beloved former Philippine president left behind. After enduring a brutal dictatorship and a historic people power revolution, it seems like the Philippines got a respite under the presidency of Fidel V. Ramos. Here's a look back at how the late former Philippine president steered the nation into stability.
Former President Fidel Valdez Ramos took the leap as President Cory Aquino's defense secretary to her successor in a narrowly contested election in 1992. He won with a slim margin, snatching 24% of the vote. Ramos's labor secretary recalls how hard the late former president worked to prove to the Filipino people he deserves the presidency.
That small percentage really pushed him to deliver. And he knew that the rest of the country wasn't his. Mm. And Cory and he had not yet gotten the rest of the country as well.
Right.
And to me that was, yeah. And that was great because it really got him to make us work as well, 24/7.
Franklin Drilon, Ramos's Justice Secretary, credits the administration's achievements to the late president's strong political will.
To him, politics is the governance of the country properly using his political clout for the betterment of our country in general. He would really insist on certain principles in our Ladakh meetings, where he believes that, a populist stand taken by us politicians will be to the detriment of the country. He would insist on he would shoot it down. So that's the politician in him. To him, politics is what is good for the country.
Aside from his good work ethic, a former cabinet member of the Ramos administration also looked up to the late president's steadfast commitment to upholding peace in the Philippines.
I asked him, Mr. President, you are a general, and but you know you have never acted at war. I mean, you made peace with the NPA, the Moro National Liberation Front, even with the Reform Armed Forces Movement. Mm-hmm. Why is it so that you, the general, are the peacemaker? And he was saying, Jimmy, if you knew what war was, because I was in the Korean War and the Vietnam War, you would never like to be again in a war.
It was during the Ramos presidency when the government forged a peace deal with the Moro National Liberation Front. Ramos also pushed for peace talks with communist rebels. Former Solicitor General Silvestre Bello III says this was possible because of FVR's so-called Bibingka strategy when it comes to resolving conflicts. Bibingka is a Philippine rice cake baked by placing charcoal at the top and at the bottom of the pan.
Yung bibingka niya kasi when there is a problem, he said na para maayos mo yung problema, kailangan pakinggan mo ang both sides. So you put it on the top and put it on the bottom. Para sa ganoon, sabi niya, mapapag-meet mo yung dalawang conflicting position.
The Peace Builder General. Now at peace.
Perhaps one of the lasting legacies former President Ramos left was lifting the Philippines from the economic mess triggered by the downfall of the Marcos dictatorship. Members of the Ramos economic team shared how they were able to do that.
The Philippines was dubbed the sick man of Asia in the 90s, a reputation obtained following the economic collapse towards the end of the regime of late dictator Ferdinand Marcos Sr. But that label was no more. The Ramos administration was best known for its Philippines 2000 program, which transformed the country from being the sick man of Asia to the region's next economic tiger. A history expert believes the Ramos administration was able to do this because its leader knew how to be the president of his time.
I've heard of people who actually say that here is someone who knew how to become a president because, for one, Cory Aquino, although she was of course a symbol for democracy and everything, he has always been termed like a housewife, no? whose presidency landed in her lap, no? But when President Ramos eventually became the president of the Philippines, I think he knew at that time what power meant, what being a president would mean. What President Ramos eventually handed to us, no, was to have an economy in which the participation of the private and the public, no, working together for sustainable development, no, to improve the country, that eventually happened. That I think that was his legacy that he left us. And I hope that it's a legacy that will last for a very long time because it will improve our economy.
Ramos's leadership was also challenged by another economic threat, the Asian financial crisis of the 90s. But his former finance secretary, Roberto de Ocampo, said Ramos was never one to panic, even amid a crisis.
Both of us, I have to include in the team facing that Asian crisis, the late Gabby Singson, who was also very close to FDR, all of us, we're not the types to press the panic button and start panicking the rest of the public. Instead, we looked at it as calmly as we could and decide from what were the parameters to be addressed, what action steps to take in a steady eddy manner. You don't just suddenly press the panic button and put in draconian measures when they are not necessary.
His former socioeconomic secretary, Shelito Habito, says Ramos' skills were further highlighted during that crisis.
One of the trademarks of President Ramos was he was known for assembling summits. We call them summits at that time, big multisectoral meetings where the leaders of different sectors of society would come together. And that is what led to the social reform agenda. It is also what led to a lot of these reforms that include the privatization of water services, especially in Metro Manila.
Jojo Terencio, Ramos's former presidential writer, says one of the toughest calls the late president had to make was to sell several government businesses and properties.
Isa pa yung nakikita ko mga comments ngayon na siya si Boy Benta. Boy Benta, di ba? The privatization. Parang yung connotation kasi nga ngayon, parang binenta mo lahat ng ari-arian ng gobyerno. But at that time, coming out of the economic crisis, coming out from the EDSA revolution, wala namang pondo ang gobyerno, di ba? So what do you do? Instead of raising taxes, di ba, you have to tap the white elephant assets of the government.
The controversies faced by the Ramos administration and the place he will forever hold in the pages of Philippine history books. Those and more when we come back.
The dress code here is informal, casual, and minimal. Titipid kami sa laundry at sabon eh.
Mababaw lang pala sir ang inyong kaligaya.
Oo. Apat lang eh.
Ano?
Apat na K.
Ano?
Kainan, kawayan, kamayan, at kodakan. Long range in our vision, you know. Long range like this, no?
Wala pa ng laman yan, ha?
No, high-tech ito, high-tech. Almost lensless. Ngayon, kung umuulan, ay di advantage din ito eh. Kasi hindi mo napupunasan yan eh. Hoy, kayo ah, madali kayong maloko ah. Mabuhay ang Pilipinas ah.
Walang bulletproof vest ah. Kasi the best bulletproof vest.
Back on ANC Presents Farewell, Steady Eddie. The media play a crucial role in every administration. It serves as the fourth estate to every government. Let's take a look at former President Ramos and the press under his watch.
In the words of a reporter who covered the palace during the Ramos presidency, the media enjoyed a warm and cordial relationship with the late former president. According to Linda Humilia, who is now ABS-CBN News Digital Executive Editor, President Ramos had a huge respect to the media and the role it plays in a democracy.
One of the best things that I appreciated about President Ramos and appreciated it more after, you know, he left office, he was really a decent person. He was never one who would blackball anyone or ball out anyone, even considering his military background. I can't recall any incident where, he humiliated people who tried to disagree with him or who disagreed with what he was saying. On the contrary, when we, in our press conference, when we would challenge or we would try to assert or go against, you know, what he's saying, he would explain to us. He took time to explain to us policies, governance, how he arrived at certain decisions.
Another member of the Malacañang Press Corps, Pulitzer Prize-winning journalist Manny Mugato, said FVR was simply one of the best leaders the country had. He also recalled the challenges of covering a very hard-working president.
Alam mo, ang problema namin, napaka-workaholic ni Pangulong Ramos. Yung Malacañang Press Corps, kailangan alas tres nasa Villamor Airbase na tuwing may biyahe siya. At tuwing nasa biyahe siya, walang tigil yung kanyang meeting, kaya hindi kayo makaalis. No, wala kang time. At ang storya, sa dami ng storya nilalabas yung dating OPS, yung panahon niya, siguro 10 storya ginagawa namin araw-araw, kaya nakakapagod, no?
Ramos's former close-in writer, Jojo Terencio, describes his former boss as a master of human relations.
Wala siyang ini-alienate na tao. Like for example, one event, he was coming out of an event and then there were rallies. The secretary, the PSCs were protecting him, and yet he decided to go straight to the rallies, ask for the person, the spokesperson of that group, and he held an impromptu dialogue. So I guess that's one thing that was embedded in me, that in any case, you shouldn't be excluding anyone.
Despite being credited for ushering in stability, the Ramos presidency also endured a turbulent time. Here are some of the biggest controversies that surrounded his administration.
President Fidel V. Ramos may have embodied his moniker, Steady Eddie, but his time in office was not without controversy. A Senate committee recommended Ramos's prosecution over the construction of the 9 billion peso Expo Pilipino in 1998. Investigative journalists claimed the project was used as a cover to raise campaign funds, but Ramos would eventually be cleared of the charges. It was also under his term that the controversial Peña Amari deal was approved, which involved billions worth of public lands along Manila Bay. Called the mother of all scams, the deal was declared illegal by the Supreme Court. Ramos saw how essential democracy and self-determination is. Yet, he bowed to Indonesia and tried to prevent the first Asia-Pacific conference on East Timor from taking place in Manila. APSET was instrumental in drawing global attention to East Timor's struggle for independence. Ramos-era policies and laws would also later be blamed for power shortages and the high cost of electricity. He insisted the situation was only brought about by policies and laws implemented after he had already stepped down. Despite the turbulence, a historian credits the Ramos presidency for bringing back stability to the Philippines. Historian Manolo Quezon points out, the shortcomings of the late chief executive are very minimal compared with his solid achievements.
He was, in many ways, a constant reminder, and will always be a constant reminder, of how the presidency is as much about managing people as it is about leading people. And there's a difference between the two. He was, in many ways, a bridge to the older generation. Let's not forget that he was the son of an accomplished politician. And so whether, regardless of his having chosen the military as his profession, he knew what civilian leadership was all about. And he was imbued by that culture. He was therefore able to, you know, after the ups and downs of so long a period of dictatorship, and then the long period, the 6 years of would democracy survive or not, we craved stability, and he gave it to us.
President Ramos cemented his place in Philippine history by steering a nation that's reeling from a crisis back on its track to recovery. Historians weigh in on what made him stand out above the rest.
22-year-old Kate Subico only knew former President Fidel Ramos from history books. Gloria Macapagal Arroyo was already the president when she was born. But it seems like history is remembering the late president well.
I really think that he was really a good president. You know, aside from he was handling the country very well in terms of the military, I think he also had the opportunity to communicate more with the mass media. He valued the opinion of the mass media as well.
He calls me Mr. Historian. And,
for historian Xiao Chua, one of the positive qualities of Ramos was his openness to criticism. This trait, according to him, should be emulated by other presidents.
Ramos was a communicator. He was able to make a lot of people understand why he's doing such things. And I guess that is the legacy of openness to criticism and respect for the media and the institutions of the academe, for example, in telling him the criticisms. I guess that's the example that other presidents should take.
Another history expert believes Ramos's good partnership with his wife, former First Lady Amilita Ramos, was also instrumental in his quest to be a good leader.
We forget that in many ways it was her duty and her privilege to restore the traditional expectations and role of the First Lady after it, of course, the role had become defined in so many ways and changed by Mrs. Marcos. She brought it back and very consciously did so. She herself said that she modeled her role as the First Lady on the First Lady of the Commonwealth and that era, a much more restrained, much more supportive, and much more traditional role. In many ways, he was a typical man of his generation with all the virtues and the flaws that included. And she was a typical lady of her generation, both in terms of her being a pioneer in the generation of having a profession, but also in standing by her husband despite all his faults.
With a good heart and an outstanding work ethic, former President Fidel Ramos made sure his legacy is forever ingrained in the pages of Philippine history.
It's almost impossible to remember FVR without mentioning the 1986 EDSA People Power Revolution. The man who once played henchman to a dictator helped the nation topple that regime. As we bring the show to a close, we put a spotlight on the late former president's lasting contribution to Philippine history, crushing the Marcos dictatorship.
Former President Fidel V. Ramos took the helm of the Philippine Constabulary, the predecessor of the Philippine National Police, under his second cousin, former President Ferdinand Marcos Sr. He was called a ruthless henchman as he commanded a security force that committed human rights abuses and arrested thousands of dissidents during martial law. Ramos insisted he was only enforcing law and order. But he would eventually turn his back on the dictator, becoming a key player in the People Power Revolt that would eventually lead to Marcos's downfall and the presidency of Corazon Aquino. FVR's EDSA jump, considered as one of the most iconic moments of the 1986 EDSA revolution and one that will eventually define his legacy. That legacy, one of Ramos's grandsons fears, is under attack.
The history of EDSA has sadly become a matter of the present culture war debate. In those politicized narratives, we often lose sight of simpler, unifying truths. That the EDSA revolution was bloodless in and of itself can be thought of as a miracle. That the AFP did not fracture, that this country was spared a potential civil war before, during, and after EDSA, is one of FVR's greatest, most enduring, and perhaps underappreciated legacies.
We had just said goodbye.
But those whose lives were touched by FVR vowed to keep that memory alive.
In 19, uh,
87, after I think the 1987 coup, he gathered his commanders, his key commanders, and basically told them, we are going to hold the line. We're going to make sure that we defend democracy and freedom, which we fought hard for.
We had just said goodbye to President Cory, and this was now President Fidel V. Ramos. So the task at hand was what? Was to be able to say to our people that it was worth the EDSA revolution. It was already institutionalizing the foundations of a good democracy.
He did it by action. He defended democracy. He respected constitutional processes. Walang mga pinakulong na mga media, wala siyang binan sa palasyo, wala siyang pinasarang mga newspapers, walang ad boycott. So for that alone, I guess it speaks more than any word can describe this.
FVR wore many hats during the course of his political career, but for his family, they want him to be remembered as someone who inspired Filipinos to continue the fight.
Fidel V. Ramos was many things to many people. A son, a brother, a soldier, a scuba diver, a loving husband and father, a warrior in battle, and a golfing buddy. By his life, FVR has set the ultimate example. But for all of his astonishing achievements, let us remember, FVR was just a man, a person, a human being, as are we all. Mortal, yes, even flawed perhaps, and yet just as capable of the same heroic acts and almost boundless achievement. He was the best of us. But if I've learned one thing from him, above all else, it is that the best is in us all. Now it is time for this old soldier's well-deserved rest. He fought the good fight. He has finished his work. But we have not. I saw that one eminent historian referred to FVR's passing as the passing of a generation. Let us instead think of it as the passing of the torch.
It's a passing of the torch indeed, because it's up to the new generation to guard the legacy left behind by former President Fidel Valdez Ramos. This has been ANC Presents Farewell Steady Eddie. I'm Tina Monzon Palma.
The pole vaulting strategy I have articulated is the Ramos administration's legacy to future administrations. The tasks it sets for both government and civil society may take not just years but decades to realize in their fullness. Carrying out the pole vaulting strategy is inherently the shared responsibility of all levels of government and of all sectors of society. Hence, we should continue to draw on the spirit of unity, solidarity, and teamwork that has energized our efforts this past 5 years.